I will share with you my thoughts about Tomislav Gotovac, who has been called anarcho-father of performance art in the former Yugoslavia. He was an anarchist, a rebel, a provocateur, provoking political and cultural establishment, and always on the margins, and actually, you know, even died in 2010, really in an old people's home on the margins of society. And in some way, his fame came after his death, when his work was presented at the Venice Biennale, and now recently there have been a number of books published about him. My interest in him, you know, started already in the past, but you know, was in a special way provoked when he had one of his last shows in Ljubljana in 2009, and I took to this show my 10-year-old son and his best friend, and we are actually standing there. I have a kind of colorful skirt. I got these images from Modern Art Gallery a few days ago and was surprised to see myself in the image and my son. Now, why this is in some way also important is that I was heavily criticized for bringing two 10-year-old boys to this show at that time. Now, what Gotovac did is, inside the gallery space is on the main street in Ljubljana. At that time, the street was, you know, full of traffic, and it was at that time a space in the bank, which now Modern Gallery doesn't have anymore. And inside this space, Tomislav Gotovac, on the one hand, he had put kind of old newspapers in the sort of the plastic bags. So this blue plastic is full of old newspapers. And inside the room, he kind of created sort of like kind of like an exhibition of, I would say, some kind of garbage, and then there were some newspapers which he had burned, and so there was, you know, kind of a lot of stuff there, old cigarette boxes, all kinds of trash was inside the room. Now, at the time of the opening, Tomislav Gotovac also did an interesting performance on the streets. But what was the third thing happening was that he was projecting into the windows of the gallery from outside. You could see it from the outside. Lots of kind of sexual films, you know, in a way we could call it heavily pornographic images of his erected penis and all kinds of sexual scenes. They were projected into the windows of the gallery. So when I took my son and his friend to the opening, these two children were quite obsessed with what Gotovac was doing. Now outside he had put more newspapers and two buckets with color, and then he started sort of walking on the newspapers and also sort of started walking onto the streets among the cars. Now, when we were observing this, a lady came to me and, you know, said, you know, why did you bring these children to observe these pornographic films? You know, aren't they a little bit too small for such an art performance? Now, the interesting thing was that these two children actually did not observe at all, you know, these pornographic films which were presented in a way directly in the windows that they were standing in front. They were obsessed with the artist, what the artist was doing. In some way, they did not at all see the films, but they were constantly observing what the artist was doing, you know, barefoot walking around the streets among the drivers. You know, he sort of was going into the street, you know, constantly kind of, let's say, trespassing. And, you know, there was a lot of chaos when the drivers had to take care that they would not damage him. Now, the children demanded the explanation of the artist's act. They were asking, you know, sort of like, why is he doing this? They were deeply curious also about the colored marks that the feet of the artist were leaving on the road. In their playful mood, they were kind of pondering if they too would be able to engage in such a performance. Thus, they examined the paints, they looked at the strategy of how the artist kept as much paint as possible on his bare feet. They were thinking, can they do that at that moment exactly in the same way? They questioned also how far into the busy road one might be able to walk until one was hit by a car. Now, in midst of all these dilemmas, the pornographic movie that was rolling in front of their eyes got no attention at all. Now, when at the end I asked the kids what they thought the event was all about, their answer was that it was about someone trying to leave a mark on the road and staying alive. Now, unfortunately, Gotovac is not with us anymore, but in some way he left a lot of marks. What kind of trace did he leave? And what do we make of his archive of experimental films, collages, and photographs of his performances? Now, on the occasion of his visit to Ljubljana, I started sort of looking into his past work. And in some way, I observed that he, throughout his life, had quite an ambiguous relationship with archives, which is why in the show in Ljubljana, he was treating the archives both as rubbish and as a kind of a valuable trash, since he felt that he needed to place this archival material, which he has been collecting throughout his life, all kinds of trash, in the gallery. But at the same time, he also took it as something that can be walked over and marked in a new way, with paint dripping from his feet. Gotovac always maintained the distance between some kind of an accepted symbolic meaning of particular objects and films and the infinite new possibilities of how they might be seen. In the same way, he never made attempts to guide his interpreters in how they should observe him. Now, this distinction between what we see and what we want to see, and how we imagine that an image might have been seen by someone else, has long been subject of public and theoretical debate. Many artists, too, have been concerned with the question of what is the distinction between what they are seeing and the reality behind it. Gotovac once famously pointed out that he was constantly bewildered by what lies between his eyes and what he is seeing. Already as a child, he was obsessively going to the cinema, often watching the same film again and again. Many times he watched a film 30 times, you know, or he could go the same, he could go every day to see the same film. Now, he says in an interview, when I went to the movies, you know, I wouldn't go there to entertain myself. I would go to work. For me, film was reality. That is why I revel in watching. That is why my every gaze is a film. As soon as I open my eyes, I see a film. When I look at something, I'm creating once again. So he said that, you know, whichever filmmaker, film director he was interested in, was it Bresson or Dreyer, they are no longer important for me. I'm creating on the basis of those things which they gave me. And I know when I see a film, even if I see it 10 times, I think this is the truth. But I constantly change. And the film changes also. In the end, you know, he says, I have been watching A Place in the Sun for 25 years, and every time I know it is different, as the viewings are different. Now, Gotovac was concerned with the changes that happen in the process of viewing and that relate both to the observer and the object observed. It seems that he was specifically excited by the uncertainty that the process of observation involves. Paradoxically, many people find that such uncertainty provokes anxiety, which is why quite often people organize their process of viewing by clinging to some kind of a steady point of view and also trying to create a certain distance from what they are observing. From, you know, studying how people perceive trauma, especially, let's say, trauma of the war, you know, it is quite often interesting to see that some people perceive actual trauma, real trauma that they observe, as a movie. I remember reading about a soldier, an Israeli soldier, who sort of, when he was engaged in war, he constantly had a perception that the reality he's observing, dead people he's observing, are like in the movie. So for him to pretend that the reality is just a movie was a protective shield. Now for this particular soldier, this collapsed, the strategy of distancing himself from reality collapsed when he once saw dead horses mixed with dead people. He said, now I knew it is not the movie anymore. Somehow it was the horses, not the dead people, that for him, you know, sort of undermined the fantasy protection he had before. You know, another soldier once observed that he was just, you know, kind of seeing like tourist images when he saw, you know, certain kind of surroundings as if he's not really in a particular kind of reality. Now, in contrast to these strategies, in Gotovets' work, we see exactly the opposite. He is constantly excited by the effects that images have on him. By observing the emotional changes that are kind of happening in him when he's observing the images, he is sort of like constantly then creating also his own new images, his own work of art. By using himself as the object of observation throughout his work, he differs in a way very much of kind of artists who in the past were interested, for example, in how some traumatic images might affect the public. Here I remember the famous kind of obsession in the past with catastrophe art, with the artists, photographer, for example, Mexican photographer Enrique Metenides or others who were, you know, obsessively capturing actual accidents, actual dead people, and so on. In some way, Gotovets is not interested in that. He's more interested in some way what he's constantly seeing in a new way himself. Now, in Gotovets' work, camera is also not some kind of a protective device, but rather a mechanism for reworking. And as such, in a way, it functions like a kind of a robot, like an extension of his brain. In a way, he's kind of using it just as a device to kind of capture what he's, in a way, in his head already captured. Now, already Gotovets' early work has been sort of obsessing with multiple perspectives that we can have on a particular scene. Now, this is an image from 62 where he has done a lot of, you know, photographs of himself already kind of half naked, not yet completely naked, reading Elle magazine. And, you know, Gotovets has done this kind of a collages pretty much throughout his life, constantly taking an image, a photo of the same scene. He had also been obsessed in his youth in capturing reality in its totality. So one of his first films in 64 is called The Circle, where he had put onto the car a certain kind of a device where the camera was rolling constantly and trying, you know, in a kind of a 360-degree circle, the camera was moving and the car was driving around and he was just, you know, recording the reality around him. He was obsessed in capturing everything. And that was, you know, quite often compared his early work like this was compared with the famous Michael Snow film La Région Centrale from 71, where Michael Snow was also in his own way trying to capture reality in its totality. In the history of experimental film, Russian director Dziga Vertov also in his own way made obsessive attempts to capture as many images of real life as possible and produce what Gilles Deleuze called cinema as machine assemblage of matter images. However, if Vertov was interested in a collage of images moving from one to another, Gotovac actually wanted to capture reality as a continuum, constantly telling the same story in different forms. An obvious comparison here is with the director whom he very much liked, Kurosawa. He watched again and again his Rashomon. And for Gotovac, he says that this story, Rashomon, is also the same story told four times. In one interview, he says about the film, "I was entranced by this one tracking shot, the sun penetrating through the leaves, and the track just goes on and on." But then he points later that after seeing the film a number of times, he was not interested at all in the story it was telling, since the content, he said, disappeared for him. All he was left was the form. So he said, "After I saw the film the 10th time, Rashomon no longer has anything to say about the content. It was at that time that I began to look at Michelangelo's sculptures. And all at once, you realize that Kurosawa was a European child inspired by Debussy, Ravel, someone who knows Italian Renaissance painting and sculpture, who knows film. You see, when, you know, Toshiro Mifune lies down, you notice that it is Michelangelo's sculpture, awakening, literally interpreted. Later, it runs through your head. What kind of things are these?" Now, here again we see that he pays a homage, an admiration to artists throughout the history of art and film. Ultimately, Gotovac himself acts as a disciple of all these great masters. It is the statues, music, films that he tries to reenact again and again in his work. And he uses his own body as a sculpture, where previous forms of art have left traces. Now, when he later in his other works walks naked around Zagreb, or when at various stages of his life he shows his body, it is as if he's making himself into a public statue, reminding us of Michelangelo and other artists who have displayed impressive male figures in public spaces. Now, this obsession with, kind of capturing what is happening around him, has been done in a variety of ways. And in his experimental films, I will just show very short kind of clip of one of the films which shows "Don't Ask Where We Are Going," an early experimental film, we don't know exactly what is happening here. We have, music, images, and a kind of a collage referencing old films. In 71, one of his moments of provocation was also when he appeared in the film of Plastic Jesus. This film was prohibited in former Yugoslavia for 20 years. It was one of the most censored film. Now, Gotovac has this, one of his many moments where he appears completely naked in the film. Now, in kind of many years later, he had done, other interventions. I will show some other images later, but throughout his life is, again, he's continuously obsessing with, you know, kind of remaking films and constantly doing kind of the same shots again and again. So one short film is all about taking a tram journey in Trieste. You know, the whole film we see just him on a tram and again seeing the reality around his journey. The people in the train, their discussions, you know, artist himself, all is kind of part of it, but primarily it is about capturing endless movement. Human interactions almost take like the side place during that film. You know, in the film which I showed before, Don't Ask Where We Are Going, again, the attempt to capture the movement, the back of a moving man, we don't know who he is, where he's walking, or who is coming towards him, it's just the movement that is obsessing him. All these films, and especially like even the first film, The Circle, where he's trying to capture the reality around him, we show him how obsessed he was with something that appears to be beyond representation. It is as if the whole film always revolves around the void. No matter how reality is recorded, by moving the camera in the circle or by trying to capture everything, you know, he's dealing with the question, what escapes representation? In some way, we can say what escapes representation is the very point of view from which the representation, the reality is observed. Gotovac, in a way, tries to transgress the fact that you usually see the world through a particular frame. Here, reality becomes circular. However, the void that is beyond representation is the very point from which the camera, and thus also we, the observers, see the world. In an attempt to show it all, to make a complete image of the world around us, and thus in some way to symbolize everything, the void from which we record reality cannot be represented, especially cannot be represented within the image itself. The frantic production of multiple circular images of reality around us cannot make up for the essential lack of representation. Now, in this attempt to represent the unrepresentable, Gotovac often resorted to images of sexual organs. For example, in a number of his works, he depicts his erect penis as if it is also he is trying to show something that escapes human control. Similarly, when he shows various images of vagina, it is as if he tries to represent another unrepresentable, another version of the void, which is at the same seductive and horrifying. Now, a Croatian art theorist, Ješa Denegri, once wrote that this obsession of exhibiting one's naked body in the public space in Gotovac appears like a symbolic gesture of freedom of behavior with which the artist appeals to his public to fight for the realization of their personal freedom. So nakedness, as Gotovac himself was saying, is kind of an archo-political act, almost like a kind of an ethical act in a particular way. Now, in a number of other films, which are sometimes very short, he repeats again and again seductive shots, either of his own body or other naked bodies, you know, repeating pretty much again and again. And when we see his body, it is as if he's showing a particular kind of a sculpture. So these two obsessions, you know, showing his body in the public space, but also trying to capture the reality in itself, are what make his art, you know, for me in a particular way, interesting. Now, when I was observing some of his other works, you know, especially sort of the collages of him, and this is like a well-known one when he's, you know, playing with his head, I was also sort of kind of thinking about other artists who have been in their own way trying to kind of capture the reality and, you know, in kind of a contrast to the obsession of Gotovac to try to, you know, record complete reality, I would sort of compare the quite recent works of Sara C, who, for example, in her installation, The Timekeeper, you know, in some way also kind of deals with the question whether one can show the reality the whole sculpture is full of wire cubes, broken mirrors, film editing table, various consumer objects, torn papers, plants, projection of moving images which circulate in and around the composition. But in some way, this collage or this sculpture does not offer at all, you know, a possibility to find any stable anchoring point of view. There is no possibility of even creating a distance by pretending that we are looking through a lens of a camera or that we are somehow able to observe what we are actually seeing. The viewer becomes part of the installation, his or her body presence in a way becomes sort of contributing image in the interplay of reflections, and they're constantly, you know, created shadows. We as viewers are like shadows, uncanny images inside the whole sculpture. And when I observe, for example, this composition, inadvertently, of course, I have to observe, I have to admit that I don't know what I'm seeing, but I'm also, as an observer, constantly also blocking any full view. And, you know, in similarly, in another thing she did recently, again, centrifuge, here we have an attempt to show, you know, in some way reality, but we are constantly dealing with the fact that we cannot see it. In one of the art of films, which again, you know, I've been interested in observing, in 79, we see Gotovac again in one of his public performances. And this is in 2007. Now, for Gotovac himself, life is perceived like a movie. He's not only an observer of films, film is also the way he lives his life and looks at life around him. He says in one of the interviews, "I do not make a distinction between life and film. I don't know if I can explain this. I'm watching a movie." Now, how Gotovac took the actual act of living as a form of performance can be observed in his explanation of why from the years 1956 to 1967, he worked as a clerk in a bank and called this, when he worked as a, just a normal clerk, that it was an employment action, that actually almost 11 years of working as a clerk was, you know, also a performance. Now, this decision to take an ordinary job was the result of his dissatisfaction, actually, with studying architecture. Although this change of career coincides with his desire to separate from his parents and take care of himself financially to earn money to pay for his passion for going to the cinema, he interpreted these very mundane reasons for employment as performance. Gotovac explains this decision to get an ordinary job you know, as a desire to be independent. And he says, what I simply wanted was to do everything on my own. I had enough of directing from school, from parents, from others. I wanted to make my own movement. I tried to get closer to the film. I wanted to be within it nonstop. In Gotovets' work, the perception of life as art has been intrinsically linked to endless repetition. Now, paradoxically, in his first action, this action to work as a bank clerk, already we see a repetition of a kind, since the clerk needs to constantly endure a routine, repeating the same work task again and again. Now, in his films that he created, Gotovets' repetition is used constantly. As I said, he's reading, he's showing the shots again and again, watching again and again the same films, repeats again and again being naked, you know, in various public settings. So throughout his long artistic career, we see this repetition and the obsessive desire to expose his own body. Now, the fascination that he has with his own sexuality is paradoxically apparent in the ways he likes to kind of change his body by cutting his hair, sometimes by shaving his head completely, and a variety of ways to play with his own beard. He's, however, even more fascinated by the changes in his sexual organ. As I already mentioned, he did numerous other short films also about, you know, his own sexual organ, his penis in a variety of images, and so on. Now, whenever he focuses his camera on his penis, it is always, you know, as if erection too is a kind of a performance itself. In regard to male and female sexual relations, Gotovets in his film, you know, for example, shows numerous depictions of his organ or the organ of his partner or someone else performing various sexual acts. But in all these cases, it is as if, you know, they are actually not pornographic films. After a while, they become even, you know, a little bit boring, again, in a way, kind of repetitive, rather non-erotic images. Quite often, you know, when he depicts his own penis, it appears as a kind of a sculpture or, you know, female sexual organ as a kind of another visual structure. He seems to express his delight in exploring the compositional possibility of exposing sexual organs rather than in the feelings that the two protagonists might have experienced during the time of the erotical act. Now, he even made kind of two homemade pornographic movies in the 70s. One is called The Family Man, where he had an image of himself and the girl at that time, the girlfriend at that time called Jelka, at the start of their relationship and at the end of their relationship. And you could see through kind of the boredom even of the images that he shows how the relationship in a way unraveled. Now, although Gotovets' films often show naked body and sexual scenes, he's actually critical about filmmaking that tries to depict sexual acts. In one interview, he says, "It is really stupid to show fucking in film, just because the film in itself is the fuck fest." He said, "Jeanne d'Arc is pure sex, place in the sun that reeks of sperm." His conclusion is that a good film actually does not need to show sexual scenes because one already gets sexual pleasure from the very structure of the film, the scenes it creates and the feeling it gives the viewer. What creates the pleasure is the way the film tries to enact the very rhythm of sexuality and not how it actually shows or talks about it. Now, Gotovets' well-known statement is that as soon as he opens his eyes in the morning, he's watching a film. However, since he cannot present his eyes to the crowd and say what he is seeing, he has the urge to produce films, to show again and again what he's seeing, always doing it in a new way. When asked in an interview if that also means that a person can watch only one film their whole life, he agreed. He agreed with the suggestion and added to it. That is what I'm trying to say. This isn't something I thought up. This was actually said by Faulkner. There have been 10 books that, you know, one can read only. It's enough to read 10 books again and again, the whole life. But what is more important is whether you have watched something or not. What you will say about it is unimportant. I guess that Gotovats would say that how we speak about his work is far less important than the act of watching it. Throughout his life, he refused to be categorized or incorporated into canons of contemporary art. It is as if he was a rebel his whole life, but didn't like the idea of being his public identity. He was someone who very much followed his own desire. He refused to give up his own desire to satisfy those of the others, the social network where he could have easily got recognition, were he to play the game of the art market. Now, similarly, he did not want to be perceived as a martyr of communism, although the Plastic Jesus film, you know, has been banned as a political film in the former Yugoslavia. At the very end of his life, the popular media in Croatia wanted to create another symbolic role for Gotovats by picturing him as a poor, unrecognized artist whose greatness the state did not acknowledge, which is why he ended up being penniless and ill in a shabby old people's home. However, even then, Gotovats refused the proposed stereotyping, this time as a victim of state ignorance. Now, when a journalist and photographer visited him in the retirement home, taking pictures of his ailing body and the unremarkable room he shared with people who seemed to have ended up on the margins of society, Gotovats did not play the expected game. He viewed the situation in which he found himself as nothing extraordinary. It almost seems as if though he was involved in another action, similar to his 10-year-long employment as a simple clerk in a bank. In 2005, Gotovats changed his name to Anthony Lauer. This act was supposed to be a tribute to his mother, whose maiden name was Lauer. However, if on the one hand this appears as another homage to someone he admired, on the other hand, it also creates a distance from the symbolic persona that Gotovats by that time had already become. It is as if by changing his name once again, he wanted to avoid being categorized. With his final act of renaming, he again retained the void between what is seen and marked and how what we observe and try to categorize escapes clear symbolic parameters. Now, in the very end, I will show some images of his work that he had done in the 90s, just after the war in Croatia. Tomislav Gotovats and two other artists, Aleksandar Batista Ilić and Ivana Kesar, for 5 years did the same performance every Sunday. So every Sunday, this group climbed to a hill and, you know, took photos of themselves continuously every Sunday. Now, after the end in the year 2000, then they started showing some of these art performances on their own bodies. Now, this art of the three artists has been interpreted in a variety of ways. One interpretation has been that they have sort of kind of subverted the idea of Sunday being the day when we are not working, and to show that actually the artist kind of works constantly, or works, you know, especially on Sunday. So one of the interpretations has been that they challenged the idea of art, work, free time divide, transforming the day of rest into working day by the artist. They were also paying homage to the film Hallelujah for Hills by Adolfo Mekos, and, you know, there were kind of trying to capture, you know, the images also on their own bodies, which I said, you know, in some way the own body of Gotovas was kind of constantly part of his performances. I found this artwork particularly interesting for Estonia, since yesterday when I took a taxi here, I asked the taxi driver whether you have a holiday on 1st of November, since in Slovenia we have a national holiday, the Day of the Death. And he said, Estonia never has holidays. I said, how come? He said, Estonians work 24/7. I said, really? He said, no day is a holiday here. And so at the end I asked Dry, but you have no free days at all in the whole year? He said, I have 7 days vacation only. So I said, oh, then it's like America. He said, America is far for us. Anyhow, maybe Gotovac in some way really did capture something with this obsession of kind of capturing the first, the only day, the Sunday, the free day in his, you know, work of art. Svaka, oh no, sorry, this is another film about...
Klopanje, seks, kenjanje ima svoje veliko mjesto u povijesti dana.
Now, this is a film which he points out how important it is, you know, to perceive everything in the day as work of art, even going on a toilet. But the very last film, which I would like to show, is the day, you know, from morning till dawn, when Gotovac decided to place himself in the center of Zagreb for, you know, from morning until the evening, talking with people and, you know, sort of sharing with them everything he does in one day. And I will show just short excerpts from it.
Protesta, jer ljudi misle da će u Zagrebu svi dobiti stanove i lijepo uživati u njima i ne budu plaćali i tako dalje.
One person is commenting that maybe a person is protesting because people have nowhere to sleep.
Bez komentara. Svako nek se izdava svoj komentar da, je li tako?
Šta to sti?
Ali baš ne izgleda da je zdravo.
Je li on pisa, šta je?
Pa je, da ne. Da vidi kako penzioneri živu zvuk.
Pa lijepi zrak, šta tu, šta mu hvali koga.
Sigurno, bjeda i ja. Ne znam šta bi rekla, žalostno.
Je mu je plaćeno što spavati?
Pa nebitno što mu je plaćeno. Uopće je nebitno, to je slika našeg društva i države.
A, gospod Gotovac je inače ikona ovog grada i hrvatske umjetnosti. Svaka mu čast, lego je tu sred bijela dana i spava. Poruka.
People are questioning what he's doing. Is he sleeping or what?
Modern umjetnost performance.
Modern umjetnost.
Ja ne dobro da sam bolestan. A vi ste bolestan.
Ne!
Kažite vi svoje mišljenje. Ko smo mi?
Ja bih htio čuti šta vi hoćete, šta trebate.
On?
Da.
On? Ali vama nisam odgovorio.
To mi je.
Mislite koliko sad na ovom trgu sad ima pacijenata koji ne znaju da su
So Gotovac is also when people are questioning what he's doing, whether he's crazy, is he ill or what, you know, what's this all about? He says that maybe he could have been placed in a psychiatric hospital, but in a psychiatric hospital there aren't many beds. You know, there aren't many spaces anymore. And he says, but we have to question how many mad people are actually walking around, you know, in this town and who have never been in a psychiatric hospital, but who might have. So there is continuous discussion with the audience. Many are critical, you know, some take it with humor. Now, at the very end, I would question whether this kind of a show would still be possible today, showing one day in life when one does almost nothing but lying in the bed, talking with people. We live in time of time management, when, you know, every minute of our life needs to be accounted for, when it is not only that we are constantly observed by others, but we're constantly observing ourselves, calculating our time, our activities, production, output. In times of utter narcissism, Instagram images, Gotovac might have been, you know, sort of another celebrity today, maybe he's even an artistic precursor of our era, since he was often saying that each is actually constantly making his own film, the film about his own life. Now, Gotovac was in a way also a director of his own biography, where the line between the reality and fiction was in a way constantly blurred. And we can say that in some way before Photoshop, Instagram, you know, fake news, he questioned in his own times, in his own way, precisely this question of sort of what is reality, what isn't, what is the power of the image, and in some way the idea that he was creating his own film day by day, you know, and showing it to the other, maybe it actually was, you know, sort of already a sign of the times that we are living in today. Thank you.